Welcome back to the Berlin Psychoanalytic. We were on a break for a couple of months discussing how to continue and restructure our effort, and now we're ready to share with you a new series of videos. The first recordings will be based on some of your requests posted on Facebook and Instagram, and please continue with your feedback and we will try to continue with the videos that reply to your requests. So the first topic we're going to address is the topic of self-analysis. Is something like self-analysis possible? Is it useful? Can it help? Is it enough? Or should something be added to it? So self-analysis, the idea of one person analyzing him or herself, is as long as psychoanalysis, or even longer. Many authors outside of the field of psychoanalysis have described this as one of the efforts that were present for some people, a limited number of people, for centuries before psychoanalysis. In his last book in the seminar, The Technologies of the Self, based on the seminars he gave at the University of Berkeley in California, Michel Foucault introduced the concept of the technologies of the self, the ways we shape ourselves as persons. And he claimed that asceticism and prayer and autobiography and many other forms prior to 19th century were the ways for people to understand themselves and try to help themselves. And as a matter of fact, psychoanalysis began in that very same way. In the year 1896, Freud's father died. Freud was 40 years of age. His father was an old man. The death was not a surprise. Yet Freud went through a very deep and long-lasting crisis, probably similar to depression. He decided not to say the prayers that were expected of a son whose father had just died, and he decided not to ask for help of anyone else. Two attitudes, probably very illustrative of Freud as a person. But then what did he do? By the end of every day, after many hours of clinical work, and in parallel with his attempts to develop a new discipline and write many books, he would spend half an hour or 1 hour on his own, thinking about his dreams, about his feelings, free associating, trying to explore his unconscious reactions. For Freud himself, and for many people in the decades to come, this was considered to be a heroic act through which he somehow managed to not only cure himself, but found a new scientific discipline. I believe now we are a little bit more critical toward this. In the first years after this, around year 1910, for instance, people believed, for instance, Chandra Ferenczi in a very explicit manner, that Freud was such a giant, such a genius, that he did not need analysis, but that everyone else in the world needed to be analyzed in order to become a psychoanalyst. Even when Freud was diagnosed with cancer in 1923 and a couple of his colleagues approached him with offers to analyze him, hoping that that would cure his cancer, Freud refused. And Freud and Jung and many other pioneers were never properly analyzed. The issue of self-analysis was very important in the first decades, when psychoanalysis was based on the idea of insight and interpretation. When people following Freud believed that what cured was truth, that finding the truth through insight and through the analyst's interpretation was what was curative. So at this period, self-analysis was something that was required of anyone, of everyone, but also the work of a psychoanalyst who would provide additional interpretations based on his or her education and personal analysis was considered necessary. So attempts to write an autobiographical novel and hope that this would cure you because you would constantly be analyzing yourself and your reactions to some traumatic events of your life was not considered enough. In the so-called second period, in the post-classical period of the development of psychoanalysis, it seems to me the importance of self-analysis is even smaller, because the second period is interpersonal, intersubjective, based on the idea that two persons together are building, founding the safe space where the patient will be able to grow, and where interpretations, or at moments words at all, are not as important as they were previously believed to be. Therefore, self-analysis is not possible. It is fundamentally made impossible by the intersubjective structure. However, there has always been a developed discussion in the world of psychoanalysis about how does psychoanalysis help. And one of the very important findings is that psychoanalysis helps through what is called post-treatment effects, that people continue developing after the analysis. And how would that be possible? The answer, I assume, could be that after the analysis is over, you have internalized the function of the analyst. You have learned, if you will, how to ask questions and how to look for answers related to what is going on in your unconscious, how you're feeling, and so on. So self-analysis will be something that will continue to take place in you once the analysis is over, because you will become capable of taking two positions at the same time, ideally. The position of the person who is experiencing something and the position of the person who can observe what is going on and ask questions about that. So in that case, self-analysis is something that follows you throughout your analysis, throughout your development, and after your analysis, but it's not the basic ingredient of it, and it's not enough in itself.